Good noon to all of you. And we had done this flipped classroom last time. And I had asked you to actually redesign your sessions and, if possible, it can be made into a flipped classroom. And I have received the redesigned flipped classroom from Arpita Ganguly, and she's here. Yes, she's here, right? And I would like to invite her to share her redesigned flipped classroom, right? So, Arpita, you can unmute your video also,
Good afternoon, sir.
right? And Alok ji, will Arpita, would you like to use your share screen type?
Yes, sir. I can share the screen.
Okay. So Alok ji, we'll have to give her the rights to share the screen, right? So make her the co-host, right? Okay, you start doing it, sharing, right? And I think, hello, is Alok is here? Okay. He seems to be doing multitasking. हाँ हेलो, ये अर्पिता को को-होस्ट बना दीजिएगा. वो शी वुड लाइक टू शेयर द स्क्रीन, है ना? अर्पिता गांगुली, राइट? ओके, राइट. थैंक यू. ओके, सो अर्पिता प्लीज गो अहेड.
Yes, sir. Hope it's visible.
Yes, it is visible. Yes.
So, sir, I redesigned this time management workshop, which previously I used to do with lot of knowledge sharing to begin with in the class itself. But
Okay.
using the flipped classroom model, I was able to utilize a lot of time in pre-work so that participants can come prepared with a few of the exercises in which we spend the time in the workshop.
Right.
So the program profile was such where an intensive one-day workshop was discussed to increase our time management and contribute to our both work life and work as well as life balance. The details of this program are designed to, of course, boost productivity with immediate takeaway like avoiding procrastination, reducing personal time wasters, prioritizing and achieving our goals to stay in balance, and and also we ensured that the course would be facilitated by trainers having previous corporate knowledge.
Okay, be a bit loud because some people are saying that they cannot
Okay.
hear you fully,
Increase the
right?
volume.
Okay, yeah, increase the volume, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, go
So
ahead.
the takeaways, like I mentioned, would include reducing procrastination, time wasters, prioritizing, achieving the main goals with top priority first, and also would be facilitated by trainers with previous corporate experience.
Right. Okay.
The schedule was such where the objective was prepared that by the end of the program, the participants will be able to recollect with 80% or above accuracy on the key learning points which are mentioned here, the various modules. And the learning outcome would be that the participants will be able to list these, the various methods or the tips shared during the workshop to apply it back into their work area provided adequate resources and organizational support is given to practice.
Okay.
The duration would be 8 hours with the equipment and the other aids which is mentioned here.
Right. Right.
So as a pre-work to understand the topic, a handout would be given with the various tips on time management, as well as some exercises that we usually do in the workshop would be made to done by the individual participants on their own, including time management self-exercise. Also, the participants would be advised to complete two different worksheets on how they are currently spending their daily or doing their monthly time management, what they do during the day in advance. And also video of the notes can be also shared instead of just a reading material to make it more interactive, using the tips like screen capture, which was shared the other day. And participants would be also advised to bring their current challenges and their understanding of the time management concept for discussion during the program.
Okay, right.
So this is like a basic module that I created with the various sessions. Like it begins with time management, a classroom, then looking back where I marked in bold in the last column that there's discussion and brief. In the next session, it would be a self-test that they did, the discussion on that and checking the learning. So it becomes more interactive with the actual problem areas being discussed. After that, the common problems and current timesheet would be analyzed and possible solutions arrived at. Post lunch, again, how we apply this back at work would be discussed. Again, a self-management to apply would be shared, and the learning would be checked at various intervals. And as a way forward, the participants will prepare an action plan on how to adopt the various solutions which were designed in the workshop, and a follow-up would be done. So as a result of this, I've just captured in brief that as a start of the program, of course, objective and agenda is prepared with the expectation setting which came from the pre-work. Also, the knowledge is shared with the pre-work only. We capture their understanding and remembering done with the start of program, with the recap and expectation session. And then actual analysis and application of the time-saving method focused more on work or job, on applying it back at work. And a few tips on life management would be discussed. Also, since this is a one-day program, we, like I mentioned, we ensure an experienced facilitator who would make it highly interactive would be chosen, with lots of questions, activities, and experiential training, learning from each other. Using the flipped technique, the application analysis and solution to the problem of managing time at work, I feel was attained more effectively, as it reduced the time of lecture or, you know, mapping the exercises within the classroom. So rather the result of the exercises were discussed more. And tools like definitely screen capture is an excellent tool to create video of the presentation itself, and which can be accessed later using central repository, which was discussed. There are several such tools, and it could be made then a virtual access for later recapturing by the participants. And also the action plan which was created by the participants can be posted in such a repository also for future access and evaluating or follow-up session if required can be done accordingly. So both the evaluation and the creation also got captured using this technique. And these are some of the basic exercises which I've shown as a format, which I used, and a separate self-management. So that's it, sir.
Good. Thank you very much. Now summarize that what are the things which I mean, just for briefly summarize, right now you had given what is the final outcome. That's a flipped classroom. So summarize, what is it that you are now going to do differently than what you were doing earlier, right?
Earlier,
so a few things, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right?
Earlier, sir, post icebreakers, I used to focus more on knowledge sharing, that, you know, what is time and what are the time wasters, or how do we manage time currently. And I also used to give these exercises during the session. So the resulting being that either the session would be stretched, or it would be a 2-day or a 1.5-day exercise. So the time reduces and the actual interaction between participants increases, because
right.
now they are actually sharing their work problems more. Now they have an understanding with the previous handouts which is given of where the session goes and the knowledge part of it, and they can share more and capture more from the facilitator. So it becomes
right.
more interactive, and they also have a method of accessing these post workshop through the various tools which is shared. So it
right.
definitely becomes more highly interactive, more charged up, and more benefit is taken out from the program. The learning is more.
Yeah. So more close to a very clear action plan, very clear that this is what I have got from this program, and this is how I am going to use my these learnings to change, and the very clear outlining that this is what I would change, right? Okay, that's the type of thing. Right, good, thank you. Can I have some suggestions and comments from other participants? Please raise your hand and come forward. Yeah. Anyone? Okay. So, Arpita, I would say that it's a fantastic sort of, change that you have made. There are a few more points you can really include them, but at this point of time, I would not like to. You will be able to discover on your own. Essentially, is that you are creating an environment in which everyone is responsible for his or her own learning, and they are using the resources and the environment that you have provided them, and then they are creating solutions for themselves. And for this particular topic, time management, each person has a different challenge, and each person is going to be creating a unique solution for themselves. And that only will work. There is no uniform solution which will work for everyone. So when you provide this type of environment in that 8-hour program, it really creates a great benefit to each participant, right? So that's the advantage of so very well. It gives me a good idea that how you have been able to totally absorb the idea, learn it, and apply the learning to your own work, right? Okay, right. Anybody else who would like to say anything at this point of time about flipped classroom? Any challenges that you have been facing? Any difficulty that you think you will be facing? Okay. I see no hands being raised. So, okay, we'll move on. Today, I want to make the rest of the session as interactive and moving it around four points, and let me share my screen for that PPT that I have got for this, and then we'll start up from on that point, on those points, right? Give me a minute. Okay, so let me see. So the four topics that I would like to handle here is one will be the rapport building with the participants, and I would like your contribution to this, right? Facilitation in experiential exercises, managing difficult participant behavior and managing questions, right? So these are the four things that I thought we need to sort of, you know, handle today. So, okay. So how do you really go ahead and, you know, develop rapport with the participants? Most of you are experienced trainers. So I would like to learn from you. How do you build rapport with the participants? Please raise your hand and unmute your audio and come forward and share your experiences.
Thanks, sir. Morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning. Yes.
So I feel that rapport building starts as part of pre-facilitation process itself. Mm-hmm. The more we know about our participants well in advance, their knowledge, their personal acumen, their likes, dislikes, the more we are connected to them from the very start itself.
Yeah. Yes.
Now, the process which actually happens when you go, there's one process which happens prior. Yeah. We are able to know about them in advance, all effort should be made.
Yes.
That's okay. Part one.
Okay.
Part two is once we are there, then mm-hmm. obviously we have to have some kind of ice breaking, probably going a little in advance, trying to know them. Uh-huh. The more we know about psychology of our participants, mm-hmm. we actually know where to build that bridge. Right. Where to score, make sure that someone who's not participating, you know, we know who are introverts, mm-hmm. who are extroverts. We get to know about their personality and then we develop it during the process.
Yeah. Okay. So it essentially is that one good point that you said is that, yes, many good points you have said, but one I would like to build on is that go to the training room in advance, right? And informally interact with the participants. And the second point which you had mentioned was about ice breaking. So the ice breaking exercise which you would be doing, and many of you would have learned about this in the presentation skills, you know. So that helps not only for building rapport amongst the participants, but also between the trainer and the participants, right? Okay. Some other person who would like to speak up? Yeah.
Sir, this is Neelam here. We can also do it through the introduction round. Once this, you know, before we start the training,
yeah.
Asking everyone to introduce themselves and tell them, you know, tell a little bit of background about themselves also really helps in breaking the ice.
Right. So that's one form of ice breaking exercise.
Right.
Okay, Neelam, to which do you belong, to Delhi chapter or which place?
Delhi chapter, sir.
Delhi chapter. Okay, right.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Right.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Anybody else who would like to speak up on this?
Harpita, please.
Please.
I also feel that non-verbal interaction, like if we mirror the participants or how we, you know, empathize or look at them, the body language, all that also helps build the rapport with the participants.
A good understanding of body language, and in fact, there are several techniques which, if you happen to learn neuro-linguistic programming, you will find that there are several techniques when you use the word mirroring. Yeah, that's the type of things which can be done to establish a bond with the participants. So competent trainer uses them quite well. Yes. Yeah.
Just to add on.
Please. Yeah.
In fact, I had attended some sessions, sir, where before the facilitator was inside, as soon as he was inside, knowing names and the meaning of the names. That means there was a direct rapport. He had known the names.
Yeah.
And then he also knew the meaning of the names. Okay. Greek names or Indian names. Also, the education qualification from where each participant has done what. bit of connection to the place where he belongs, he or she belongs.
Right.
Now, these are the things which connect an audience, a participant. Immediately, there's a rapport made.
Yeah, that's right. Calling the participants by their name when they are participating, or even if they are not participating at that time, you can say, yes, so and so. What is your view? Right? Okay, and like that, that makes the person feel that he or she is, is valued in the program, right? So when the people feel valued, they essentially their attention, etc., goes very high, and you start getting better results, better learning results for each one of them, right? So that's a. In fact, one of the senior trainer, I found him to be giving using this in a different way. So if suppose one of the participants has mentioned a certain answer to his question, then he will say, okay, so this is Mr. Verma's law, that and later on in the session he would use it again many times. Okay, this was Mr. Mehta's law, or this was Mr. Verma's law, and then when that sort of thing, though that may be something which may be a common occurrence or a common statement, or maybe something which is well known to others, but it becomes sort of personalized, individualized, and that used to make the people feel very much part of of the training. Right. Okay. Right. Anybody else would like to say?
Manisha, this Manisha, side.
Yeah, please.
Sir, though I'm not into training as of now, but yes, being into human resources, during the induction program, we have this ice-breaking session.
Yeah.
And we had a twist into it, whereas we divide the people into a group and let them know each other.
Yeah.
Now, the twist of the game is reflection. Whereas, when it comes to introduce, they are introducing each other, basically. Right. Say, for example, A and B, they are talking to each other. So now, A will be representing B and B will be representing A. Yeah. So, this is quite a more engaging, whereas, people are more attentive while listening to each other, that what is their interest, disinterest, the college they passed out or the background. Okay. So this is how we give a twist to induction program.
Right. Very good. Right. Which is in fact part of the, one of the type of icebreaker. Right. I would like to mention one, aspect of this rapport building is that what many of you have mentioned so far is more on cognitive level in terms of knowing them and connecting with them, etc. There's also an affect level, at the level of emotions also, and it may not be easy, it may not be required also, but yes, connecting with the participants on an emotional level, it essentially means that a trainer has to develop and should be a very well empathetic person. Now, what does empathy really means is that being able to, there are many definitions of empathy, but I'm sharing this, that being sensitive to what the other person is feeling. Knowing one's own feeling is one good quality, very much required in order to manage yourself. But in order to manage my relationships with others, I need to be sensitive to, and I should be able to understand what other person is feeling. So one of the key quality that a trainer should be having and should develop it, if you don't have it in so much capacity or in so much amount, is empathy. Now, empathy has two aspects. One is, of course, being able to understand what the other person is feeling. The second part of that is being able to express your emotions in such a way that the other person feels comforted or feels that he or she is well understood. So the whole issue of empathy is one of the key quality which would help you to build rapport with the participants. And it may not be possible immediately to do that with every participant, but yes, even if you happen to do it, and if it is seen by many others that you are able to build a rapport with one or two participants also on the feeling part, others feel very, very comforted, and others feel very much trusting you. So that creates a good rapport. So the rapport, not only on the level of knowledge of each other, but also on the emotional level, that has to be sort of, you know, there. You should not get overwhelmed by the emotions. Only thing is that management is required. Yes, connecting with another person on emotional level is a art that a trainer should really develop. Right? Okay.
Excuse me, sir. This is
Jyoti Verma. Yeah, please.
I want to ask how to build a trust before the session to build a rapport, sir.
If you already know the people and you are a known person, that is means if you are known in the sense that you are giving training to the people in your own organization, in that case, there will be a certain amount of sort of, you know, what is called an image. See, it's important for us to understand that people, in an organization, there's always an image of each person which is going around, particularly the senior people. And if you happen to be one of those senior persons, and trainers typically are very core type of person, means almost so many more people know trainers, right? Because they interact with us. So when you have a good image in the organization, there is a preconceived trust that gets that the participants come with. अच्छा उनका program है अच्छा वो तो बढ़िया होगा चलो ठीक है they trust that person is competent, they trust that person has a certain level of integrity. So the trust would be on competence and on the personality. So that is quite a bit with that. However, trust building essentially happens in the interactions. So in the interactions, as you will find in your way of conducting yourself, either increases the trust that the participants have in you, or it decreases the trust. So you have to be caring or careful about that always, because trust is very critical to your being able to be effectively communicating to the participants. Because if a participant does not have trust in me, whatever I'm saying is not being being listened and absorbed by the person, right? Okay, can we have Neelam, please go ahead, Neelam.
Yeah. Yes, sir. I think another very important aspect is that the trainer should be smiling and he should be approachable.
Yeah.
Because if he's rigid, then he may scare the trainees away. So that's a very essential step, that the trainer has to be, you know, smiling and approachable.
Yeah. So your looks and your demeanor would be a very important thing for you to be able to develop the trust with the participants, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay. I have a question, Arpita, here.
Yeah.
Is questioning skill also a part of rapport?
Okay, yeah, we'll look at that in more detail, but yes, you see, the question that you put in and the way you put in can help you to build the rapport, right? Yes, so it does connect with that also, right? Okay, So I'll move on to the next topic, and that this topic is facilitation in experiential exercises. This would have been done in the last semester, right? You know, when you were doing this entire course of experiential exercises, you would have done it. In currently, for the first semester, Rekha Bhadwaj is taking the sessions, and she's another very fantastic trainer. So what really happens is that experiential exercises are all where the people are, I mean, the participants are working through. And your job is not to push them. Your job is to create an environment in which they, and give the rules, give the guidance, so that they are discovering for themselves. They are engaging in an activity. And in that, two aspects which I emphasize are, now, for briefly, let's recall the experiential learning cycle. The experiential learning cycle. Would anybody like to recall the experiential learning cycle? Okay. There are four steps in that. Anybody raising hand? Anybody? It's not too far off. You wouldn't have forgotten. Okay. I see no hand being raised, so I will go ahead and revise that. Experiential learning cycle starts with you do something, that's you have an experience, that is the second step is reflective observation. And in reflective observation, you are essentially saying, okay, what happened, what was what, etc. Now you start developing connections and start developing a sort of a theory about it, which is essentially is abstract conceptualization. And then from having developed that theory, having developed that law or rule, you start looking at how do I apply this to my situation, right? So that becomes the experimentation or action. Right. So these are the four stages. As we have, learned earlier in that course, in the experiential learning methods, what happens is people have preference for two out of the four steps. So because of that, they develop what is called the different learning style. Right. Having preference for the different learning style, they are likely to do certain steps very well, and they are likely to miss out on certain steps. That is where you have to understand the group and cause the group to go through all the four steps systematically, right? And that is the challenge of the facilitator. That is when you are conducting the experiential exercises, it's not important to only conduct an activity, but after having conducted the activity, you have to ensure that the two steps or the three steps of reflective observation, abstract conceptualization, and the experimentation all are done quite well. Right. So would somebody like to, reflect on this as far as the session or the program design was there in, Arpita's time management program? Anyone who would like to do that?
We have a lot of process in armed forces.
Yes.
Talk about training how to fire a rifle itself. There is a experiential training involved.
Yeah.
And the trainer is neck to neck with the trainee.
Yeah.
Step by step. And as you said that right from the stage of experiencing, then reflection, then developing a conceptualization. And till application. So that is more and more practice which he gets.
Yeah.
Now, when we saw the program by Arpita in the morning, she also had kept some sessions, some intermediate sessions where whatever was being taught was being experienced at the same time. That means whatever is a theory in communication aspects, though I'm not recalling the entire session plan, she had made a very good session plan where they were group participation and they're trying to actually do things practically first. That means speaking to each other, communication.
Yeah.
So there were some hints of it.
And you know, towards the end when they were doing that action planning, etc.
Yes.
And then, you know, the goals for themselves and, you know, this is my daily schedule. Those were the things, you know, which were where that was a plan for action, right? That was being
planned for it.
So you are pushing them to that aspect. So through other things also, you know, so there were some elements of this were there. So it's important for me to emphasize here is that I find that many people do several type of activities in terms of sort of, you know, conducting a team building program or a leadership program or a communication program. But I find the new trainers are rather weak on the aspect of debriefing. That is, there would be less of reflective observation. There will be less of rigorous abstract conceptualization. And then they will say, okay, whatever they have learned, they will, it's for left for them to apply in whatever manner they would like to apply. So that that is something which I would say, as you become more experienced trainer, you must take responsibility for the learning of your participants and start pushing them, nudging them towards that. Yeah.
I just wanted to bring out, sir, every time a ship leaves harbor or it comes back, there is an action checkoff list for every equipment to be operated. And in spite of the fact that everybody is well rehearsed with those actions, there is always a debrief with every exercise which we do at sea.
Yeah, it is done quite well in the armed forces. In fact, I know that even for every sortie that is made as a part of practice every day by fighter pilots, there is a debriefing. There is a very clear critique, debriefing, etc., which goes on.
Yes, sir, yes.
Right? So that's a good, that's where, you know, we create a strong army or a strong air force. Because one of the things, you know, which I really found was Mr. Agarwal is taking sessions on the business strategy and HRD. And, you know, one of the things he said is you know, when we do the SWOT analysis of an organization, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats, many people look at resources as a very good strength. Is it one of the important things that you need to learn about resources is that the resources are your strength only if you have the right capability to use the resources. So if you have a, you know, AK-47, but you don't know how to really use it, it's as good as not having it. In fact, it is a risk. Somebody else will pick up and put it back at you. So that means AK-47 can be a resource, but without the real capability, you just can't, that is no more a strength of yours. And similarly, I would say, I hope nobody minds it. You know, many times we say, Jharkhand has got great resources. There's so much minerals, etc. But the point is, who is going to exploit those resources? If the Jharkhand people are not having the capability to exploit those resources, the resource does not have the value. There is does not become the strength, right? So that's important, and that's one thing that is good about our armed forces, that yes, it is not just the resource, it's not just the equipment, but the capability to use the equipment is very important, very, very much emphasized. And that is why, if you, those of you who can recall, in 1965, our pilots fought with net aircraft, and Pakistan had F-16. F-16 was, by any comparison, was a great, much greater aircraft. But who won it? It was mostly the net or the Ajit aircraft, our people who won it. Why? Because we had the capability, So that's it. And in building up the capability, these aspects are very much required. This is what we have to understand. The training is critical for building up the right capability. Right. Okay. Shall we move on to the next session, next topic, or if there is anybody else who would like to share some aspect of this? Okay. Fine. We move on to the third topic today, and that is managing difficult participant behaviors. Every one of you would have found in some way or the other, in some training programs, some participants act difficult. Now, sometimes it is easy for us to say, okay, managing difficult participant. But I won't use the word managing difficult participant in that manner, because I wouldn't label a participant as difficult, but I would label some of his or her behaviors as difficult, right? So first of all, I would like you to really share with me what are the difficult participant behaviors that you have encountered in your experiences.
So during one of the ISTD programs, we had one officer with us who was, in fact, this is all actual experience on ground. He was from the fire department, and the personality was very overbearing. He would just make sure that whatever he has to say, he would make everybody believe that that is the gospel truth, and there is no end to it. And he would, kind of overpower all the discussions. And then he had the ability to justify also. I'm not saying that. But sometimes it used to be very difficult in a group environment when we had group discussions and all that, not to follow him, because people were literally afraid. I mean, I was from armed forces, but I could manage it.
Okay.
Others from.
So you have, you have participants whose behavior is very dominating. Yeah. Okay.
Yes, dominating.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Right. So that's one of the challenges.
And there would be a contrast of that. Those who would not just come out with anything. So that's also not
okay. Easy. Yeah. Okay. So you have another challenge is that you are asking the people to share, etc., and then there are some people who are shy. Maybe they are introvert, or they are so that's it. Another challenge. Okay, good. What are the other challenges?
I would like to share. There are times when the participants, some of the difficult participants, unnecessarily keep asking questions in sessions just to check if the trainer is having the knowledge or not. And they will do it too often, and it's very obvious that they're just doing it just to keep on checking if the trainer knows the answer or not. So I've seen several participants like that.
So these are the continuously testing the trainer, testing the patience also of the trainer sometimes, right? Okay. So okay, let's now right now list out that. We'll then go for the second round, where we'll start looking at answers or solutions to such this thing. Okay. Yeah.
So very careful approach is required.
Yes.
Okay. You have to be not direct at all whilst dealing with them, and in group dynamics, sooner or later, he or she would discover that there are others who have a better point of view, and So giving adequate opportunity to others by a facilitator at that point of time, and that too very subtly, you know, you don't have to make it very obvious to him or her, because so he should not get discouraged also at the same time, and the point also has to be understood.
Yeah. So if you recall, we had used the two terms, gate opening and gate closing. So for you know, people who are not ready to share, we have to open gates. We also have to shut the gates. We have to close the gates on some of the participants, and how we do it in such a manner that it does not really offend them so much. That's the art that we need to really develop. So you are going to have a fairly sort of, you know, different type of difficult participant behavior. And I would like to give some more examples. For example, you would agree that when you are conducting a session, and if it is in the classroom, not like this, I can't sort of, you know, control what you are really doing. But many people have this, that they will keep on looking at mobile, and their full attention will not be there. So that becomes a problem, right? Some of them will take the mobile calls and then push off from the room. That is another problem. So, right. So here, what you have to do is, how do you handle such people? You would have created a norm right in the beginning. You would have said that this is what will be our norm. Nobody is going to look at the mobile. Mobiles, if it is possible, you will ask them to surrender or keep them on the mute and put them at a table which is far off from them, not in front of them, right? That is also we have tried. What else can be tried? So I would like to have some practical, like, sort of, you know, solutions for this. Yeah.
Sir, this is Neha from Mumbai Chapel. So what we did, we had one session at Chhattisgarh. And there mostly people were senior, the participants.
Yeah.
So what we did was, because we used to face this often every day, this was the problem. So with the discussion with the group itself, with the participants itself, and with their readiness itself, we decided that anybody who touches the phone or whosever phone rings, we will collect 10 rupees from them every time. And after the session is done, after the training is done for the day, we would you know, bring some snacks with those money collected, with that money collected,
okay,
have a party. So that worked a lot, because people didn't want to, even though it was just 10 rupees, but still people didn't want their money to be, you know, wasted like that. So that's what we did, and it really, really helped a lot.
At middle and junior level, this works quite well, right?
Right,
That is what we have also, I have also experienced, that yes, we can have this sort of thing. It can be good fun also, right? At a senior level, if suppose the people are senior and you are not asking them to part with this, all of them have put the things, put their mobiles on the silent mode. But still one person happens to pick up a phone. And, you know, there can be very specific reason for which he is picking up the phone and is excusing himself out. One of the things which we have tried and worked well is that at the point anybody goes out of the group, we just stop and we wait for the person. So it can take a minute, it can take 2 minutes, it can take 3 minutes, but we just don't talk. We whole group is silent. Person comes back and we still don't talk. And then he looks around. If feels, what is it? Okay, fine. Welcome back to the group. We say, tell him or her. And then we say, okay. So where were we? And we start up. He says, why you people were not talking amongst yourself, or you're not carried on? No, we waited for you. We had just suspended our discussion for the time for which you were out. Now, this creates a great sort of, you know, I would say, great amount of responsibility for on each participant. And I typically have found that when I deal with the senior people's group, I don't find such behavior at all. You know, they just don't do it, right? I find it more at a middle management level. At a junior level also, I don't find too much of a difficulty as far as mobile behaviors. There are also other type of, you know, nuisance being created. Now, I'll tell you, in one of my program, there was a bank, and from one branch of the bank, the branch manager had come, but it was a man, and he had also brought a colleague of, that is somebody who was reporting to him. So she was also there, and they were sitting together, no problem. But within the class, they will keep talking among themselves in whispers. I were told, they stopped it for a while, but they will still keep doing it. I had to then actually take them aside and in the break tell them very clearly, you may be very close colleagues of your each other, that's something, that's no problem, but please either sit separately or stop talking, because here both of you are equal, you will have to maintain the discipline. And that they realized, okay, bhai, I'm a trainer, though I was outsider, but I could have, if they had not stopped, I would have asked them to just leave the training program. So that was that would have been a very extreme thing. But a trainer has to sometimes be very clear about this type of issues also. So yes, bringing in people who are shy, who are not participating, that becomes a people who are dominating, you will have to manage them. And in fact, in one of the books, I think of yours, which one is this? I do not know. In one of the books, there is a good sort of, you know, description of difficult participant behavior. And you can learn from that. I don't want to sort of, you know, repeat that misuse the time that we are having right now. Okay. So, good. That's managing difficult participant behavior. The fourth one that I would like to do is managing questions. As it is, we have been talking about questions quite a lot. But here for another, short period, 10-15 minutes, I would like to know from you, what are the challenges you find in answering questions or managing questions?
Sarpita here. One thing I find is that trainer to a large extent can also be honest. So if it is somebody who's asking questions which are, even though intended to maybe slightly check a little bit more on the trainer knowledge, we can always quote a time that, you know, it's an excellent question, but I'll get back to you in, let's say 24 or 48 hours, but then commit the time and do get back. So the sincerity works. And also what works for me is reflecting the question back to another expert in the room or back to the audience so that they can answer. And also if somebody's asking too many questions, then the rapport that we have built with the rest of audience, they support and they often ask that, okay, you know, now let's get into another topic. That has worked for me.
Right. Okay, very good. So as a trainer, you do not have to be know-all. कि मैं मुझे सब कुछ आता है नहीं I'm competent, I know certain things, but of course there are many things in every area, there are so many things which you may not know. So yes, this is the way to be honest and should be able to come back to the person, that is one thing. And otherwise, using the group only as a resource means Somebody else in the group may have the answer to that, and using that can be also a good way of handling the question. Yeah, Varang, please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Managing, yes, sir. Sir, managing question is the most important and the critical factor in a training program, because the way we, as a trainer, we anticipate that training should be as more interactive as possible. So that interaction may not go somewhere else to ensure that we have an effective question answers round in the middle of the training program. So it is advisable, and that's what I use whenever I train, either in offline or online mode. That it's good to have questions, and I appreciate every participant having questions, and we can have a doubt clearing sessions. Perhaps it has to be in a normal way. It has to be in a rational way, so that we do not skip the context, or we do not jump in between the context when it's going on. So either you have a question, put it into a parking lot. Once the topic is finished, we'll be addressing all the questions so that we can have a rational discussion, and all questions which has been asked can be addressed. In case, as Advita said, if there is a question which needs time or which is not relevant to the current topic, we can put it into the parking lot, and you can come back next day or whenever the time permits.
Yeah, very good. Because it depends on the type of session you are conducting. Some of the sessions are very sequential. They have to be followed. They have to follow a certain sort of sequence, right? And they are highly structured. And then there is a progression, right? So one has to ensure that that in such cases, some of the questions can divert your discussion, etc. So you will have to use what you have used the term parking lot. So if you have a parking, okay, so you say yes, good question, but we'll park it for the time being and come back to it. And either the question would have been answered as you have gone as you go along, or at the end of the session you can really handle that question, right? Okay. Very good. Okay. What else? Yeah. Who would like to? So there are, first of all, it's important for us to see, as a trainer, what is my attitude towards the questions. When participants are asking questions, sometimes a trainer feels irritated. What this question? It's a stupid question, etc., etc. All that. That should not be the attitude. Remember one thing: if suppose you are a salesperson and you have made a sales pitch, after the sales pitch, you ask your prospective customer or the prospective set of customers, okay, any questions, anything, any objections or anything. Now, we train the people in the sales program that, if there is a person who is raising objections, look at this whole issue, that it is good that he is raising an objection. Because if suppose he does not raise any objection, he just says, okay, this was a nice, lovely presentation, thank you very much, we'll get back to you. Now you know that you have lost the opportunity, isn't it? Now, for the salesperson, an objection is an opportunity. Why? Because that means that the person had been listening to you very, very attentively. Another thing, he perhaps has intention to buy, right? Therefore, but he has a problem, and the problem is he is raising as an objection. The problem or the objection could be about the price, or objection could be about the size, objection could be about the after sales service, etc., whatever that may be. And a good salesman knows that if I can handle the objection clearly, I have completed the sales, because I'll get the order. So similarly, you must have your attitude towards questions, that questions means that's good. That means questions my participants are asking me, questions that means they were listening, that is why they are asking questions. Number two, they are trying to adjust this new knowledge or new understanding in their mind, right? And they are finding, they are asking you to help them out, right? So through the questions you are, and through answering the questions, you are helping the participants in and getting a good understanding of what has happened or what has been learned in the program. Also, there is some aspects which have not been handled by you. You might have thought in my regular session, I will not handle it. And in case there is a question which comes up, then I will handle it because it might be not very relevant for every person. So you have said, okay, I keep it for a end of the session in case somebody asks, right? Okay. So that's the... And one of the simple things which I always tell people is that when you are conducting a session and you have planned a session with the session that you have designed and planned and you are ready to deliver, please also make an FAQ. All the websites have got FAQ, isn't it? So what is the frequently asked questions? So make a list of the questions that you anticipate will be asked in my program. And if they are very likely to be asked in this session, so make a list of those questions beforehand and also have answers for them. Now, it doesn't mean that you will only get one of those questions, you know, from the participants. There can be new questions also. But because you have had a list of frequently asked questions, FAQ with you, you also have ready answers for them. That would mean that you would handle that Q&A session of your Q&A part of your session quite confidently. So that is also part of the design of the session, that when you have developed all this, you also create what is called FAQ for your session, right? Okay.
So this asking questions finally is an art or a science?
See, the questioning is a logical process, right? So, and there is nothing like art and science. Everything that we do has a part which is science, and everything that we do has a part of the art, right? So if you are looking at even a, you know, preparing a good dish, there is a recipe, there is a clear cut this thing, that these are the things to be used. But then ultimately the taste that really comes from the dish is essentially because of the finesse, the competence, the art that you have developed. So it is not, there's nothing like art and science are not two different things. In everything that we do, there is an art part and there is a science part, right? That's how I would like to ask.
This was, sir, one of our questions in the in our assignments which we submitted for this term.
Oh, acha. So you have
I just shortened it up.
Okay.
But it was a question in nothing.
Yeah.
And I think I wrote both the things. I said it's both an art and science.
Yeah. So in every aspect, in every part of our life, there is a science part of it and there is a art part of it, right? So we have to be competent in both parts, right? Okay. Science mein phir bhi ye hota hai ki if two people are there, at least we can bring them on the same level. The art part of what we are doing is has a very unique imprint of our personality and who we are in our profession. So even as a trainer, you will have, training has got lots of science which is being shared with you, and there's also a lot of art which is also, which you develop as part of, as through the practice and through the skills that you develop, right? Okay. Right. Okay. Any more questions? Any more questions on questions? Right. There again, good coverage on this managing questions in the books and that have been given to you. Please go through that. I'm not recalling or repeating that part of it. So we are perhaps if we have nothing else to say or do, we can. Yes.
So when I was doing my assignment, I was a bit confused between two. What is the facilitation technique and what is the facilitation skill? So what is the basic difference between these two, sir?
Okay. Right. I have distinctly brought those things separately. So, okay, fine. I think I'll do that. I'll just start that particular PPT, right? So give me a minute to do that and I'll share with you the difference between the two, right? Okay. Okay. Are you able to see this? This is facilitation skills which I had listed out. Yeah. Are you able to see this?
No, sir, it is not.
No. Oh, I have shared the screen right now. Okay. We get a little in this. Okay, right. Yeah. So this is what I had listed out as some of the key facilitation skills that could communication skills. Active listening, empathetic listening, being able to structure the thought process is clarifying assumptions, fact checking, differentiating between judgment. That was one quality or that you develop. Rigorous reasoning, a rigor in reasoning, questioning the right. This is not managing question, but this is questioning. Means you as a trainer, you should be able to ask the right questions. Giving feedback, advocacy, balancing between advocacy and inquiry. These are the first skills that I shared with you, right? If you find a few more, please do let me know. I'd like to add to them, right? The facilitation tools that I had shared with you, general problem solving framework, brainstorming, consensus mapping, mental plan B, parking lot. We had used the parking lot over there as one of the facilitation tools and techniques, multi-voting, affinity diagram, and one aspect of an affinity diagram we had used was mind mapping, right? There is a cause-effect diagram, which is typically you will see cause and effect, which is a fishbone diagram, so which many of you would be familiar with. What-if analysis, particularly the another form of what-if analysis will be in the scenario building exercises, force field analysis, incongruity checking, debriefing, six-hat thinking. Now, by no means these are an exhaustive list. This is just a typical sort of, you know, list of more often used tools and techniques in the facilitation process, right? Okay. Does that make it clear? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes, right.
Sir, this is Neha this side. Sir, I would like to know, is there any difference between tools and techniques for facilitation, or it is one and the same?
Both are used interchangeably, and they are used some together also, facilitation tools and techniques. Okay. So, for example, if a tool is, you know, like, give you a simple example. If you are an electrician, you will have the tools. Tools are very clear, hard, this thing. A screwdriver is a tool, right? And a plier is also a tool, right? Okay. But technique, using that, how are you doing this, would be the technique, right? So tools and techniques, many times, you know, in our work, we use it interchangeably and sometimes together. So if you give a specific example, then you can really figure out whether it should be more classified as a tool or a technique, right? Because it's a mixture of, I mean, these are mixture of some like a hardware and software.
Thank you, sir.
Right. Okay. Any other questions or anything? Okay. So we'll close it, and what we'll do next time is link of a case.